good morning to you. I want you to take your Bible or turn on your Bible this morning. And for the summer, we're going to be in Matthew chapter 5 through Matthew chapter 7. One of the things that came back to us from our Christmas survey is we said, where are you in your walk with God and what's taking place in your walk with God? How do we live this Christian life in this world that we're living in? How do we take the teachings of Scripture and how do we live them today? How do we live them in our lives? And Jesus came to his disciples in Matthew chapter 5 and said, now listen, for generation after generation after generation, you have heard it said, this is how you live your life. For generation after generation, you have understood through the Old Testament, this is what life is about. But Jesus comes to his disciples in Matthew chapter 5 and says, I've got some new information for you. Did he abolish the Old Testament? No, not at all. He didn't do that. He fulfilled it. He said, let me give you the fulfillment of what is taking place right there in Scripture in Matthew chapter 5. We call this whole passage that we're going to look at this summer, we call this whole passage the Sermon on the Mount. Now, keep in mind that in Matthew's life, that his target audience, if you will, who he was trying to sell his book to, he wasn't really selling his book, but who he was writing to were the Jewish people, and they needed to see Jesus as the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Now, a little confused, because they not only wanted to see him as a king, they wanted to see him as an earthly king, and Jesus was coming as a heavenly king. Now, Matthew was the author of the book of Matthew, of course, but a despised businessman who was a tax collector, and he had a toll on the road from Damascus to Capernaum. He had a toll booth, if you will, and he would charge you taxes as you traveled and charge you taxes sometimes on a floating scale based on what you had with you. Now, the Gospel of Matthew is composed of two subheads, the narratives of what Jesus did, but also the teachings of what Jesus taught in his life. Augustine was the first to call this passage the Sermon on the Mount. Others were like the compendium of the Christ doctrine, the Magna Carta of the kingdom, the manifesto of the king. And Matthew, the accountant, aren't you accountants, you engineers? Matthew spent 107 verses walking through this Sermon on the Mount that Jesus delivered to his disciples. Luke, the doctor, wrote that old scribbly prescription, 35 verses. Just kind of hammered it out, kind of gave us, but Matthew gives us the details of Jesus, the King. More than likely, this message, this devotion, this new way of living was delivered to his close disciples and others that were just listening close by that could listen and hear what Jesus was saying to his followers. But I want you to remember that in biblical times, they would stand up to read Scripture, but they would sit down to teach. And that was the posture of where Jesus was. He sat down and taught his disciples some great truths from God's Word. It's intriguing to me that as we go through this COVID-19 situation that we're dealing with today, that Jesus teaches us exactly where we are in our world today. In that, how many times have we thought, wow, I'm so tired of this. I'm tired of where I am in life because it's taken away some of my joy factors out there. I love being with people, some people say, and it feeds my soul to be with people. I can't be with people. I love to travel and I love to go, and I can't travel and I go, and it feeds me. It gives me energy. I'm out of sync with where life is, to where I can go and do and see and accomplish and all that. And I can't do that anymore, and it seems to be taking my happiness away. Kind of sinking into a depression, some of us have said, because I'm not doing what I normally do in the ebb and flow of life. And it's interesting that when Jesus pulls his closest disciples to him, the crowd were following him, it says in verses 1 and 2, but Jesus went up on the mountainside and he sat down and he began to teach. Those that could get an ear were listening to him. And he said, this is where I want to start with you. Happiness. I want you to be blessed. That word blessed means a divine joy of and perfect happiness. That's what that word means. Divine joy and perfect happiness. Isn't it incredible that our Master, that our Savior, the forgiver of our sins, the sacrifice for all that we've done wrong, starts with us and comes to us in our life and says, I really, Well, he said elsewhere, I came that you might have life and that you might have it in abundance. Remember that? I want you to have happiness in your life. Just heartbeat. That's his passion. He doesn't want us to go through this life in drudgery with poor attitudes and sour outlooks on life and just getting through the day. He wants us to have. He started with the subject, a perfect happiness, divine joy. That's pretty cool. That's how much he cares for us in our lives. I don't know about you, but whenever my birthday comes about or Christmas comes about, Lynn always asks me, what would you like for your birthday? What would you like for your Christmas? I've never chosen socks, a tie, underwear, and not going there. I always have a list of tools that I need, because if I had this tool, then I could accomplish this faster or better, or I broke that tool and I need to replace it, whatever the case may be. I think it was Christmas. I asked Lynn, she asked me, what would you like? And I said, I would like some Bluetooth headphones. In fact, I saw some at Argo Power made by steel, and they're strong enough for a chainsaw, and then my phone could Bluetooth to them. Lo and behold, would you believe that's what Santa brought me last Christmas? It's just amazing how that works. So the other day I had on these, I don't know what I was doing, but I was doing something loud and I needed to protect my ears. And so I just Bluetooth with my phone, and I was just working through my iTunes, if you will, and I was working through some songs, and I thought, you know what? I'm kind of in the mood for some Alan Jackson. And I thought, I'm in some movement. I'm in the Chattahoochee and Drive and all these. You know, I'm just kind of in that kind of summer mood, you know. And I believe I'm going to listen. I'm going to listen to a little Alan Jackson. So I clicked on my Bluetooth, and I just shuffled Alan Jackson. I got a couple of albums of his, apparently, and I just shuffled Alan Jackson on there. And I want you to hear, as I was outside sweating and outside working around loud equipment and that kind of thing, I want just listen to what came onto my headphones as I was experiencing summertime.
Silver bells, silver bells.
Now just picture that, if you will.
It's Christmas.
Go to silver bells.
Time in the
city. It's cold. There's a fire in your fireplace.
Ring-a-ling.
A Christmas tree. Your den is decorated with different
ring.
Things on the mantle. Just go
soon
there for a second.
It will be Christmas Day. City sidewalks, busy sidewalks, dressed in holiday
All right.
style.
Can you picture that
in
with me? You know, as I was just doing my task and I was just drilling in on what I needed to do, it was hot and sweaty and had my shorts on and just getting bug bitten, scraped up and all that kind of thing. Then all of a sudden in my, I'm tired of COVID-19, I thought, I'm ready for Christmas. Because when Christmas comes, hopefully we'll be through with all this. It may come again. I know all the stuff, but surely Christmas will be better. We'll be with people and we'll have candlelight services and we'll have the Christmas tree up and it'll be cold and there'll be a fire in the fireplace and family will be around and everybody's in a good mood at Christmas. You know, people are happy. Even mean people are happy at Christmas. It's just, I'm ready for that. Christmas shouldn't be the source of my happiness. Neither should summer. Neither should job support for performance. Neither should how well work is going, how well behaved the children are, how the marriage is going. Those things should not provide happiness. Jesus said happiness is divine joy and perfect happiness, not external things, but internal things. So this morning at the 30,000 foot level, Jesus is going to give us some principles we need to live by. Just three quick principles we need to live by if we're going to have happiness. And you say, well, Pastor, you can't go through the Beatitudes in three quick cuts. I know we can't. That's why on Wednesday nights, we're going through them step by step. I hope you were with us this past Wednesday night. You can be with us this Wednesday night as we go through one more Beatitude. As we dig down and drill down, Jesus, tell us where happiness can come from in our life. But this morning, 30,000 foot level, we're going to first understand that there was a principle of position. If you want to have happiness in your life, you've got to live your life by this principle of position. This principle of position in that Jesus says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Now, if you were with us on Wednesday nights, you know what that means. You've got it because you studied it with us on Wednesday night. That terminology, poor in spirit, means a dependence on God. That we're not walking with pride. We're not walking with arrogance. We are walking with a humility, a humble heart, a dependence on God. So that position, principle of position, blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed is that person who walks with a dependence on God. Elsewhere he says, blessed are the merciful, so they will be shown mercy. Well, that gives you the position, doesn't it? Somebody that gives grace and mercy to other people, someone that wants grace and mercy from our Heavenly Father, for the measure we use will be used against us, right? So we want mercy in our lives for our failing and our shortcomings. If we stand before a holy and a mighty God, we want God's mercy. We want the mercy of other people as well, so we are merciful. We're not arrogant. We're not prideful. We're not demanding. We're not legalistic. We're merciful. Blessed are the merciful. Because in your position, you will receive mercy, it says. Blessed position. Principle of blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the sons of God. Blessed is that person who walks to make peace, not stands by the principle that this is right and it's just the principle of the thing. Oh, I hear that every time somebody gets in a jam. It's just a principle. They're going against the principle. No, blessed are the peacemakers. That you give up your principles? No, but you're merciful. It's a position. Remember, we live this life in this principle of position. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the sons of God. They will reflect the very joy and the happiness and the peace of Christ. They'll be referred to as someone who's a Christ follower. Why? Because they want peace. Same thing Jesus gave us when he appeared at his resurrection. My peace I give you. My peace I leave with you, he said. Blessed are the peacemakers. Listen, we'll never have joy. We'll never have happiness in our life if we're constantly living. We're constantly living in legalism. We're constantly living in these are the rules, and if you get outside the rules, you're off my list. You're wrong. Are you telling me not to live by principles? No. I'm just telling you not to be the Holy Spirit. It's not your job. The Holy Spirit is capable of being the Holy Spirit. Amen? He's big enough, bigger than us. We live with mankind in love like Jesus. Go and sin no more, Jesus told, right? Right? Jesus looked over his city and he wept over the city. We want to love like Jesus loves, and we live by this principle of position. Blessed are the poor in spirit, that person that has a dependence on God. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. The person, and blessed are the peacemakers, those that have a hunger and a longing for peace. You'll be called a son of God if you're a peacemaker. The kingdom of God, blessed are the poor in spirit, the kingdom of God is theirs. That's where God hangs out. It's with people that are poor in spirit, dependent on him. We see that again in 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 6 and 7. Humble yourselves, therefore. Humble yourselves. As a follower of Christ, as a dedicated follower of Christ, those are two important words, and you know that. Because if you don't humble yourself, he will humble you. I would encourage you to humble yourself. Much less painful to do that than to fall under the discipline of God. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. What a truth. What a truth that we can humble ourselves under God's mighty hand, that in due time he will lift us up. And all the things that take our joy and take our happiness away and bring anxiety on our life, he said, just give it to me. Give me your anxiety. Man, I love you. I care for you. I died for you. I want you to have happiness. I want you to be blessed. But you've got to live your life by a principle of position. that you're under God's mighty hand, that you have a dependence on God, that you have a passion to be merciful and a passion to be peacemakers. And you say, well, Pastor, I'm not very humble. I'm very rigid. I'm very set in my ways. And I don't know that God's ever humbled me in my life. I would be concerned, my friend. I would be very concerned. If you're a rigid, dogmatic Pharisee of a follower of Christ, you think, and God has never humbled you. My friend, He humbles His children. If He hadn't humbled you, you've even hardened your heart against the voice of the Spirit of God. I would question your relationship with your Savior. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that He may lift you up in due time. Humble yourself. Cast all your anxiety on Him because He cares for you. A principle of position. Jesus also says, you know what, I want you to live your life under my authority, under my rule, because I care for you. I know what's best for you. I'm going to lift you up in due time. I'm going to bring the joy back to your salvation if you'll walk with a dependence on me. But I also want you to give me your problems. I want you to live by the principle of problems. Because I got problems, you got problems, all God's children have problems, and all of God's children said, amen. We do, every one of us. I got my list, you got your list. The key is not the problem, the key is how we deal with our problems. Every one of us have problems. It says, blessed are those who mourn. Happy are those who mourn. Why? Four, may want to underline that. Four, they will be comforted. Comfort will come into your life. Why? Because you're not going through this by yourself. And you think, well, how can I be happy if I mourn? Because all of God's children have, everybody has problems, right? All of us have problems. But when we go through this principle of problems, we know that we're not alone. We know that there's comfort that will come to us in our lives. And that brings us some peace. That relieves our anxiety, that God is with us. He cares for us. He goes on in verse 10 and says, blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness. Not persecuted because of stupidity. Not persecuted for being dogmatic. Not persecuted for being hard to get along with. Not persecuted for being mean and lying and being dishonest. No, 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 no. That person is not blessed. Blessed is the person who is persecuted because of righteousness. Because they're living for Christ. Why is that person blessed? Because the kingdom of God is theirs. Because God is there. The ways of the kingdom are there. Eternally, the kingdom of God is there. We know that this is temporary. This isn't permanent in our life. Jesus said, listen, if you could live your life with the principle of problems, that we have problems. Yes, yes, yes. Some of them tragic and severe problems. But we know that God's with us. We know we're not alone. We know God wants to take those problems and He wants to bless and He wants to honor and He wants to anoint those problems. He wants to bring bad, Romans 8:28, good from bad in our lives. That's the kind of God that He is, and it brings us some happiness. It relieves our anxiety. It relieves our pressure to know, God, this stinks, but I'm not in it alone. I have a Savior standing at the right hand of the Father interceding on my behalf. That helps us. That's a comfort. That gets us through that struggle and those heartaches. As Jesus walked through these principles, how to live your life in a happy way, He said, listen, you're going to mourn. There's going to be times, but you're happy as you mourn. You're comforted as you mourn. You're going to be persecuted just simply because you're living the Christian life. But God takes notice of that. The kingdom of God is there. So in our mourning, in our sorrow, let us approach the throne of grace with confidence. Let us approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Wow, wow, wow. When that mourning comes, when that heartache comes, when that difficulties come, some people run from God. And some people make a choice. Even in their anger toward God, they run to God. Jesus said, you're going to be comforted. The kingdom of God is yours. God can handle your anger at Him. He can handle it. Run to Him and find help in your time of need. approach the throne of God. Even in your anger and your lack of understanding and your heartache and your mourning, run to the throne of God and say, God, help me. I'm hurting. I'm mourning. And God will comfort you in a way that only He can. That's what Scripture says and promises us in our life. Keep running to God as we mourn, as we're persecuted, as difficulties come into our life, not because we're stupid, but because we live our life for Christ. Keep running to God. Do we run to God when we're stupid? Yeah, we still do, because we all make mistakes. But run to God. 30,000-foot level. Wednesday nights, we'll dig down on each one of these, one on Wednesday night. But this morning, Jesus says, listen, if you could just live your life by principle of position, just have a dependence on God and humble yourselves before God. If we live our lives by principle of problems, knowing that we're going to have problems, but God is with us in those problems. But careful here. It's a principle of power. And you automatically think, well, I got that. I got the corner office. I got the windows in my office. I'm on the top floor. Oh, I've got that. I'm independently wealthy. Nothing can happen to all my wealth. Oh, I've got that. I've got the perfect family. I've got the white picket fence. I've got the power. I'm successful in what I'm doing in life. No, you're missing it. You're missing it. Go think of power in a different way. Not an earthly power. Jesus is trying to flip all of that upside down in our lives and trying to change all of that in our lives. Because He said, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. You know, you remember, if you've been in the faith very long, there's two people in the Bible called meek. One was Jesus, and the other was Moses. You remember also that that word meek means power, but under control. A bridle in a horse's mouth. You've heard those illustrations. Blessed is that person who is powerful, has their strength from God, under the control of God, realizes that he or she is a son and daughter of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, like Jesus, like Moses. Blessed is that person who is meek because they live under the control and the power and the influence of the Spirit of God in their life. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. They have a passion for it. They don't have a drive for higher sales. They don't have a drive for another corporate office, another location of their business. They don't have a drive to make another million. They have a hunger and a drive for righteousness. They have a feeling in their life that nothing else can provide. Blessed is that person who has a hunger and a thirst for righteousness. Blessed are the pure in heart. Person not scarred by the things of the world, but has, as that verse 6 talked about, a righteousness, a purity in their life by what they say, by what they read, by what they watch on TV when the kids aren't around. Hunger and thirst for righteousness, a purity in their heart. Blessed is that person who has a purity, for you will see God working in your life. You'll walk in close fellowship with your Creator. You'll have a oneness, John 17, with your Heavenly Father. Blessed is that person who is pure in heart, have a hunger and a thirst, is meek in their life, a strength that is under control. It's a principle of power. A principle of position, yes. A principle of problems, yes. We understand how to handle and adjust our problems, but we also have a principle of power in our life that our strength does not come from us. Our strength does not come from our accomplishments. Our strength does not come from what we achieve in our lives. But our strength comes from God and what God provides in our life. It's just a 30,000-foot level. It's just a skyscrapers. Every Wednesday night, we'll dig down and drill down on each one of these as we go through the summer. But today we understand that Jesus said, man, more than anything else, I want you to be happy. I want you to have some divine happiness in your life, not based on external things, but internally in your life by your position and how you live your life and how you handle your problems and by the power and the resource of your power and the source of your strength. I want you to live your life there. C.S. Lewis says, God can't give us peace. God can't give us peace and happiness apart from himself, because there is no such thing. Apart from Christ, you'll never have peace. You'll never have happiness. You'll never experience what Jesus wants to provide us apart from him. Let's pray together. Father, how we